So just talking about the big picture of the universe, what I'm showing you is a pie chart of, you know, the composition of the universe on the larger scales. Now, these are results from all the experiments that look at the cosmic microwave background, for example. In particular, this pie chart comes from the results from the Planck Observatory. And what we know through these experiments is that what we call normal matter, you know, the stuff that makes everything down here on Earth, is actually a very small, thin wedge in that pie chart. It's a yellow wedge that is the baryons in the universe. That are those are things like protons, electrons, etc., that make up normal matter. And then there is a much bigger wedge, which is a blue wedge, that is dark matter, for the lack of a better name. It's just matter that, for whatever reason, doesn't seem to have electromagnetic interactions of any sort. It's just we know that it's there because of its gravitational influence. And then the biggest piece of the pie is something that is even more mysterious, and is dark energy, which actually, you know, takes the place of a pressure, an energy density in the universe that we don't know very much how to explain. So that's the big picture. That's how the cosmologists see the universe. And the point to make is that, you know, dark matter is 5 or 6 times more abundant than normal matter. And this is a spoof of one of these motivational posters done by Sean Carroll, saying, you know, dark matter, most of the universe can't even be bothered to interact with you. Because that is essentially what happens. The only interactions are gravitational interactions. So we see the influence of dark matter in pictures like this. This is it's one of the early surveys of a very large chunk of the universe, and, you know, each one of the points there, of which there are many thousands, is a galaxy. And what is being plotted in the radar direction, you know, the angle is just a position in a slice of the sky, and then the radar direction is the distance from us. And what you can see there is that the universe has a funny structure. You know, galaxies align themselves in things that seem to be walls, or actually they seem to be the edges of bubbles, essentially. There are places in between, you know, for example, where nothing is happening, and then there are many more galaxies around the edges of that void. So that particular structure we can understand as a direct consequence of the makeup of the universe, the fact that dark matter and dark energy make up a substantial amount of the universe. So now, when we make one of those pictures, what we're doing is we are trying to assign a position and a distance to a galaxy like it was a point source. And so what we're doing is we're looking at pictures like this, taking spectroscopy or pictures like this. And this is, you know, one of the most beautiful pictures taken by the Hubble Space Telescope, is a Hubble Ultra Deep Field. So many days of integration with HST. And the thing that probably many of you already know, but a lot of people don't necessarily realize when they look at this picture, is that pretty much everything you see there is a galaxy, it's not a star. No? So there are a couple of stars in that picture, the rest are all galaxies. So you can zoom in and just look in there, and you see galaxies, and you can zoom in to another piece and look in there, and, you know, you see galaxies. Everything is a galaxy. This is the universe we live in. So can we explain the properties of the galaxies in this picture in any way? No, this is what we astronomers, professional astronomers, you know, try to do a big fraction of our time when we're doing research. And the way we try to understand the universe is through, one way we try to understand it is through simulations, large-scale simulations of the universe running computers. So here I'm showing you one of them, is a Millennium simulation from a group in Germany. And what you're seeing there, let me backtrack for a second and start it again. What you're seeing here in this corner is essentially a clock. So it's starting from the very far past and coming into present times. And what you see there is that the universe starts from very smooth conditions. Those are the conditions that we see in the cosmic microwave background. And then through gravity, essentially, gravity is a force that has only one direction. It's purely attractive. There is no anti-gravity. So even if you have something that has that is fairly smooth and you let gravity operate over a period of time, gravity collapses things, and that is what you're seeing here. So those very, very smooth initial conditions in the universe, through the force of gravity, get converted into these filaments. Here you're seeing the voids and the filaments. The different particles here are, you know, the size of galaxies essentially, and what is forming there in the center, that funny structure that is right there in the center, and you know, these all the funny structures are clusters of galaxies in the universe. That's the size scale of the picture you're looking at. So this is the understanding we have of why the universe has those voids and those walls of galaxies. And you see them in our simulations too. That's the way gravity operates. The thing is that what is in these simulations typically is, you know, things that we can put in simulations nowadays is, you know, mostly gravity and geometry, cosmology. But in reality, we want to use these simulations to understand, you know, that picture that I was showing you before, the Hubble Deep Field. So we need to make galaxies out of the particles in our simulations. And what that entails is entails understanding how those agglomerations of, you know, matter get gas into them, how that gas becomes denser and forms stars, and how those stars give you the galaxies that you see in a picture like this. You're looking at light from a star, you're not looking at dark matter or at gravity. So, you know, putting all that together means going through many, many steps. This is a simulation in the computer. That is the observable universe. And in between, there are many steps having to do with star formation, for example. And this is where ALMA comes in. I mean, all this was to tell you, give you some idea of why we built ALMA. This is where ALMA comes in, because ALMA actually looks at all these stages having to do with gas falling into galaxies and forming stars, and actually being also moved out of galaxies through the formation of stars and galaxies. There is a very rich ecosystem, if you want to call it like that, of stuff coming in and out of galaxies as a consequence of all the physical processes that happen in them. The question is, why did we take all that work of going to Atacama? I mean, was it for tourist reasons, or, you know, looking at the wildlife and all that? This is actually taken through one of the trips that I took over there. Last year I was in Atacama for a number of reasons. I was observing one of the telescopes that is also, you know, relatively close to ALMA. So I got to take photos of vicuñas, and this is, in the blue is my student, and this is a colleague that was with me in the observation. So you can see it's a beautiful setting. But the real reason why we went there to build ALMA is because it's the driest desert on Earth. Chile is full of telescopes, full of optical telescopes, and the reason is that, you know, the air comes from the Pacific Ocean as a dominant wind, and then it's sort of in a laminar flow because it hasn't seen land for a long, long time. And then suddenly hits the Andes. And even there, still, the scene is very, very good. That's why we build optical telescopes there. And then once it gets over the Andes, it falls on the other side of the continent, and then it gets all scrambled, and the scene becomes horrible. So we are on the good side of the Andes. And what we have for going to this altitude, to the dry place on Earth, is spectacular atmospheric transparency. So what I'm showing you here, maybe hard to see, but it's a plot of atmospheric transmission as a function of frequency in this axis. So this is radio frequencies, microwave frequencies. And the different lines and the different colors represent what happens with the atmosphere when you move to a higher place and a drier place. Essentially, the blue is 5,000 meters in very, very dry conditions, 0.1 millimeters of precipitated water vapor, which is a dry time in the Atacama Desert. And the thing that is, you know, over here in the black, where essentially there is nothing down there, it's just zero transparency in those high frequencies, that's a very good place in the continental US. That's 3,000 meters and 3 millimeters of precipitated water vapor. So we just wouldn't be able to look at any of these high frequencies if we were not in this very special place. So I'm just zooming this in, the lower frequencies, and just trying to give you an idea of the wavelengths. So the VLA, for example, in Socorro, operates in this part of the atmosphere. That's all it does. And as you can see, it's very transparent. It doesn't really matter that you are at a much lower altitude and in a wetter place, because it's still very, very transparent. But then you get into these wavelengths of 3 millimeters, 2 millimeters, 1 millimeter, and shorter wavelengths, and you really, really need to go to a very high, a very dry place to be able to see anything through the atmosphere. Okay, so this was during last year's visit to the plateau. And one thing that I'm sure you noticed when I was showing the pictures, and you noticed when the introduction was on, is that it's not a single dish telescope, it's not just one telescope, it's a collection of telescopes. So the question is, why do we do this collection of telescopes instead of just going with one single big telescope, like the one we have here in West Virginia, in Greenback, which the GVT, which you should visit because it's spectacular. So these are the two biggest, or two of the biggest antennas on Earth. The thing in here is Arecibo in Puerto Rico. That's a sea level, but it operates at very low frequencies, so that doesn't matter. The diameter of that antenna, I mean, that's a valley with just this structure building there, is absolutely impressive. If you get to see it, it's quite an engineering feat. This is 300 meters of diameter from one side to the other, so 1,000 feet diameter. This is the largest steerable telescope on Earth. That's the Greenback telescope, which is 100 meters in diameter. Okay? The reason why we build these big structures in the radio is because of the diffraction limit. And what the diffraction limit does is relates the maximum angular resolution that you can get with the size of the telescope you have. No? So in an optical telescope, you don't worry about that because seeing is actually what limits you. But in the radio, seeing doesn't limit you for the most part. What limits you is the size of the antenna you're using. So if you want to do as well as Hubble does at optical wavelengths, Hubble is diffraction limited because it's in outer space, so it doesn't have an atmosphere. If you want to do as well as Hubble does at optical wavelengths, you need to do, you know, resolutions of 0.1 arcseconds. And you know, for that, you will need a wavelength of 1 millimeter, you will need a telescope that is 2 kilometers in diameter. Now, if you try to build a telescope that is 2 kilometers in diameter and operates at a wavelength of 1 millimeter, you're going to bankrupt the country doing it. It's just impossible. From the engineering standpoint, it would be incredibly expensive to do. So we don't do that. We have some clever workarounds. And the clever workaround is actually not to build a solid single dish, but essentially to make up the aperture with a bunch of smaller antennas. No? So that's the idea here is, essentially, instead of using one big single mirror, is to break the mirror in pieces. And you may think that that is a bad idea, perhaps from personal experience, but that's actually can work, and it has been shown to work, in many cases, even for optical telescopes. So the idea is this. I mean, you all know that this is the idea of a telescope. Essentially, you know, the light comes from infinity, you have your parabola, or something close to a parabola in the telescope, and that actually makes all the light rays converge into one point. Now, you know, there is nothing that will stop working if I take out a piece of the parabola. No? As long as I leave whatever I have, the rest of the parabola in place, then that will work perfectly well. No? So that's fundamentally the idea. We don't build a big parabola because we can't afford it. We just build the smaller ones. And then we have to place them into the right place. And the way we do that, because this is radio after all, is not by, you know, building some giant scaffolding and hanging them from the right place. If we just line it up electronically, no? We can control the delays between the different dishes. We can essentially tell light to take a longer path from here to there than it should. And we do that. We control that with a big computer. And that way we can essentially make all these independent smaller telescopes work like a gigantic telescope. So what happens is that we pay a penalty. And fundamentally, the more telescopes you, the more small telescopes you have, the more sensitive you are, and the better you can reconstruct your image. So actually, ALMA has 50 12-meter antennas plus 12 7-meter antennas plus 4 other antennas. And the reason for that is that all those antennas operating together give you, you know, what is it, 1,291 pairs. And each one of the pairs is a mini interferometer and gives you information in a particular place. So it has many more antennas than the VLA and has many more antennas than any telescope that was built before in this weather regime. And that is the reason why we did it, because that many antennas actually gives us a superb image reconstruction. Now, those antennas are pretty expensive because they have to have very high surface accuracies. So the antennas are 12-meter antennas. The big array has 12-meter antennas, so 12 meters in diameter. And the surface accuracy is 25 microns. No? So all those panels, carbon fiber that make up, it's aluminized carbon fiber that make up the surface of the antenna, they are set with a precision of a mil over the 12 meters of diameter. And the reason is that you need that, otherwise you lose a lot of efficiency. You just, you know, your telescope is too rough, it just doesn't work. The total cost of the observatory, once you factor that and the receivers and the tremendous computer that has to back all this up, is $1.4 billion, and that is shared between three big entities, essentially. The US is one-third partner. The European Solar Observatory, which is a big conglomerate of European countries, is another one-third partner. And East Asia, which in reality is Japan, Taiwan, and now Korea, is another one-third partner in the enterprise. So add that to Chile. In North America, it's not just the US, it's the US and Canada that are partners here. But you know, getting all that, all those countries together will make it possible. So we have never done anything like this before. This is a learning experience. Things are getting, you know, more expensive, and then you need to do this. And that people who do, for example, high energy physics and particle accelerators have been doing this for a while. This is the first time that we reach the point in astronomy where we need to pull a lot of these countries together. So those antennas can be moved around because that's part of the attraction of an interferometer. You can actually reconfigure to have different resolutions. And for doing that, you need something like this. That's there are two special purpose transporters that pick up the 12 meter antenna, move it around, and then drop it. And it has to be dropped with, you know, exquisite precision at some place. So there they are. I guess that's a very small car, but it's still a car that is coming under the transporter. So they have names, that's Otto, and this is Lori. And that's Lori transporting, picking up one antenna, moving them around. In terms of collecting area, well, I mean, it has a lot of collecting area. It's much more powerful than anything we had before. I was showing you before the transmission curve for the sky. And here what I'm telling you is that, you know, all those windows, each place where the sky was transparent actually has a receiver that operates in that band. Those receivers are, you know, pretty exquisite piece of engineering. When you get to the very high frequencies, you need to do special things to make things work. Those receivers are 4 Kelvin receivers. They use superconducting insulator, superconducting junction technology. And they have, you know, many stages that they are cryogenic. Each one of the receivers essentially fits in a much bigger cartridge that is has a very hard vacuum and that is cooled to 4 Kelvin. And that goes into the antenna. So this is the inside of one of the cartridges. You can see that it looks like an IMER, but I'm sure that the engineers know what each piece of that is. A lot of the stuff that you're seeing here is oxygen-free copper straps that are used to pull pieces, and then there is a lot of cabling that goes with things. So that's what happens in the antenna. And then the signals are collected in the antennas. They are digitized in the antennas by special purpose digitizers. And then they are sent down a fiber link to a central laboratory that is also at 5,000 meters. And that is the central laboratory has the fundamental piece of equipment that is the correlator. The correlator is this supercomputer, it's a special purpose supercomputer that essentially takes all those signals, delays them by the right amount, and then mixes them in the right way. Takes Fourier transforms, that's what it does. So the main correlator is pictured in there. It is a big room in that building. It has 134 million processors, and it is a supercomputer. It's just a very special purpose supercomputer because it does multiplications and additions only. But it's 17 quadrillion operations per second of computing power right there, so 17 petaflops. And I was looking at how does it fall in the ranking of supercomputers. It's not ranked because special purpose, but if it weren't special purpose, it would be the third or the fourth most powerful supercomputer in the world. And all of that is operating at 5,000 meters of altitude. Takes a lot of AC power to actually pull that down. So the operations are at 5,000 meters, but it's not particularly pleasant to be at 5,000 meters, believe me. So people do the minimum that they can there, and then everybody actually lives at 3,000 meters of altitude, because that's about the limit of what you can do with some comfort. So there is a big essentially support camp at 3,000 meters of altitude, and there is a road that goes all the way into the plateau. And in the big camp, there are many contractors and engineers, etc. There is a control building. The whole array is controlled from 3,000 meters of altitude. You only send people performing servicing and engineering up there for some period of time. You cannot send them for a long period of time. So that's what it takes to do this type of thing, and it's a very big enterprise, and it takes an army of engineers to operate. Essentially, it's about 300 engineers to do the maintenance of all of this. So it's a big experiment. So we managed to build it, and it actually works, which is pretty amazing, if you ask me. What is it good for, is the question. So we get together from time to time to discuss the science results. We have only been operating the observatory for about 2.5 years or so. So the second conference for ALMA took place in Tokyo, Japan, in December last year. Was a big group of people there, getting together to discuss the science results. And I just want to give you a mix of the science results that have been appearing in press. So let's go over that. A lot of interesting things that ALMA can do are related to the formation of stars and planets. So here is a picture taken by HST of a nearby star, Omahot. And this is a star that has a debris disk orbiting around it. Okay, a debris disk, we think, is something like the asteroid belt, just bigger. And there is a lot of dust that is associated with the debris disk, and there are probably things grinding among each other to give you all that debris. In this particular photo, what HST is trying to do is trying to put a finger on top of the star so you are not blinded by the glare of the star, and it's just looking at the stuff around. So when you do that, you get these diffraction spikes, etc. But you can see the dust ring over here. And in fact, there is a candidate planet orbiting that has been seen a few times. And so it's just a bright spot in the dust ring there. So this is the image that ALMA took fairly early on of the same dust ring. So now, instead of using optical light, we're actually looking at very, very far infrared. So what you see there is dust glowing by itself, just because it has a temperature. Okay, so it's thermal emission from the dust. And the striking thing is that it's very, very thin. The dust grain is very thin. And what that implies is that there has to be something like the Shepard satellites that keep the rings of Saturn being very thin, because otherwise there is a time scale for essentially losing the thinness of the ring. It's just you cannot maintain it over a long enough time scale. Okay, so when you see a thin ring, it's a hint that there is something else there. And that's indirect evidence for actually more planets in Pomerol. One of the very neat fairly recent results is the imaging. So that was a debris disk. That is something that happens fairly late after you form the star, etc. Then you got rid of all the gas when you form the stars. And then the debris disk is something that happens because of the grinding of planetesimals against each other. But early on, when you're forming the star, you actually put together another disk. And that is a disk of gas and dust also, but it's called a protoplanetary disk. So the protoplanetary disks are hidden behind a lot of extinction in a molecular cloud. So it's totally hopeless to try to look at them in normal light. You have to look at them in the radio. And that's what was on late last year. And this is the disk called HL Tau. It's a protostar in Taurus. And what you see here is some of the, ALMA was for the first time in a very, very long configuration that gives you a lot of resolution. And that's when you took these pictures. These are three different wavelengths, so three different receivers. And what you see in there is all real. Actually, that protoplanetary disk has a bunch of gaps in it. So it has rings. And those rings are actually the telltale of structure caused by essentially planets accreting in the disk. And the surprise is that as far as we can date, protostars is a fairly young protostar. It's only 1 to 2 million years old, and yet clearly the planets have been there for a while and they are already clearing a gap in the disk. So that is a process. The formation of planets actually happens fairly quickly. Once you're trying to accrete a star, you end up having planets. I mean, we also see a lot of molecules. The whole molecular clouds are full of molecular chemistry in them. People have been hunting for biomarkers or biomolecules in space. And we have been finding it's hard to essentially understand precisely what the spectrum is telling you. You have to identify the many lines, etc. And there's a reason why ALMA is particularly useful for that, but it's a technical reason, so let's not go into that. But this is the detection of essentially what is the simplest sugar in space. So it's glycoaldehyde, and it's around a protostar, and those are the many transitions identified on the spectrum of glycoaldehyde. And then it turns out that they also see the products of the dissociation of glycoaldehyde, which is antifreeze, which are the lines marked in red. So I thought that this was a very good example of biomolecules in space. In case you're wondering, as I said right there, it's, as a sugar is sweet, but it's also toxic. So another thing here is it's an aging star. It's an AGB star that is actually ejecting part of the atmosphere. And so we are seeing that. And the surprise here was that when ALMA took the image, which is this image to the side, what you see is a perfect logarithmic spiral in the ejecta. And that is actually telling you that there is a companion to the star. So it's a binary star. We didn't know that it was a binary star. And what happened is, about 2,000 years ago, it went through a thermal pulse. And what that made is essentially ejected a big chunk of its atmosphere. And that's what we're seeing out there. And it's because of one star orbiting the other that we see this spiral-like structure. So one more thing here. This is the Sculptor Galaxy, NGC 253. It's a fairly bright galaxy, but it's southern. People recognize it, good. So it has an active nucleus. It's one of these examples of a very active galaxy. It's forming a lot of stars in the center. And now we know that when there is a lot of star formation in the center, there is also a lot of gas that is being ejected. This, the big formation of stars in just one place, actually, it sets up what is known as a supergroup. So this galaxy is getting rid of gas at a very high rate. And we went with ALMA, we imaged that. And one thing that ALMA gives you is, it gives you three-dimensional data. So the three axes are position, as you see in the sky, but it also gives you the spectral dimension, it gives you velocities. You can interpret shifts in the spectrum as velocities because of the Doppler motion. So what is shown here is that observation of NGC 253, and it's just a cube of data that comes from ALMA, and it's being rotated around the velocity axis, so the vertical axis velocity. And you see from different positions, essentially, there. And there is, doesn't matter what, one of the things I can point you, it's just disappearing there, but essentially that is the ejecta from the center. Okay? So you can put these data together in three dimensions because of ALMA. So finally, let me talk to you a little bit about one thing that ALMA is very, very good for, and is for catching objects in the very distant universe. And the reason for that is the following. I mean, you all know that the universe is expanding. And what that means is that the farther you are, the more redshifted you are. So actually, that moves your spectrum in frequency. And in the radio waves, it actually moves it in an interesting way, because this is your spectrum if you were not redshifted. And then, because you're farther away, it comes down, but because it's redshifted, it moves to the right. So what that does for you is that in the wavelengths in which ALMA looks at, there is no distance correction. You can see objects that are, you can see equally well objects that are relatively nearby, a redshift of 1, to objects that are, you know, all the way to the edge of a cosmos, a redshift of 20. And that's essentially exemplified here. That's a Hubble Deep Field, and this is how many distant galaxies you will see in the Hubble Deep Field. But we know what the distances are, so that's how many distant galaxies there are. This is what happens when you take a deep field with ALMA. You see a lot of galaxies, and you see a few more, a few less when you look at very high redshifts. But you know, you still see plenty of them. So we have been taking advantage of this particular effect with other telescopes too, and we have put, you know, big figures of the universe together. And one of the interesting things we discovered was that this was, you know, fairly unexpected. People started surveying very large swaths of the universe, and they were actually looking for something called the Sanyaev-Saldovich effect, which will give you a deep, so something that is dark, a spot that is dark in the cosmic microwave background. So they were looking for something like that. That is a spot that is dark in the cosmic microwave background. So they found that, but they also found these other spots that are very bright. There was a big discussion about what those were. Turns out that those are galaxies that are experiencing gravitational lensing. So these are galaxies that are far, far in the background and are being lensed by a galaxy that is much closer to us. And because they are being lensed, you know, the light is converging again, the light rays are converging again, they are being magnified, and they look much brighter than they have any right to be. So we have found several of those, and actually we have verified that that is the case with ALMA, because we point at those objects, and we actually see the arcs and rings that are the telltale of a gravitational lens. That's what you're seeing right there. And you know, very recently, we actually, ALMA did, because it was, again, those very long, very large configuration. ALMA did an experiment looking at some of these galaxies. This is one of them. And you know, it's almost a perfect Einstein ring. You get the Einstein ring when the background object and the foreground lens are perfectly aligned. When you have the Einstein ring configuration, you get the maximum magnification. So you get things to be the brightest possible. That's why they are being picked up, because they are very bright. So let's go back to where I started, which was these simulations, large-scale simulations of the universe. Again, as I was saying, the objective here is to understand better how galaxies are put together. So we can simulate the universe in a box to, you know, an increasing degree of sophistication, I would say. But to actually predict what we see right now in the universe, to claim that we understand how things are put together, that takes a lot of information that we don't have. And that information is the reason, looking for that information is one of the reasons why we built ALMA. The other reason is what I was telling you in the beginning of the science part. I mean, it's looking for how planets are formed, how stars are formed. Just to put this in the context, I mean, you can make a diagram of, you know, what goes into building a galaxy, etc. And that's what is here in the diagram. And then you can go through the exercise of asking yourself, well, what would I be able to observe in this or this other step? And, you know, the purpose here is not to make you read each one of the labels, but it's just to show you that a lot of these elements can be actually observed directly by ALMA. That's the reason why we built the observatory. So the conclusions are that, well, I guess by now we all know that we are in a fantastic era for astronomical discovery in general. I mean, with things like HST and the big optical telescopes that are ground based and with the other big facilities, we have been able to disentangle many, many questions. But, you know, from my standpoint, at least as a radio astronomer, this is going to get even more exciting because now we have a completely new instrument that is a fantastic instrument and that will actually help us reveal many, many different aspects of the universe that we have very little information about. So it's a great complement to things like JWST, so the follow-up of HST, because it looks at other wavelengths, but it can see that the universe there with the same resolution as JWST or HST. Okay. So thank you very much, and happy to answer questions.